originally two lectures planned today to be deterministic, and second to be stochastic. Hope to be excused that I swapped them, and instead, probably for you, it's all in all the same, and start today to speak about the recent results obtained with Oleg Alexeyev. So, the title of my talk I have to update in this stochastic Laplacian growth. A week ago or so, I overviewed deterministic Laplacian growth, at least on the simple pedestrian level, to understand contact with experiments in laboratories with nonlinear interface dynamics. Today it will be a little bit more mathematically involved presentation. And my next presentation, I will speak about interesting integrability properties of deterministic Laplacian growth, which gave rise to many really unexpected branches of modern mathematical physics, including, closely speaking, quantum Hall, seriously speaking, random matrix theory, and two-dimensional quantum gravity. But today it's about stochastic Laplacian growth. Let me immediately let you know why stochastic is really important here, perhaps even more important than in many other branches of physical processes, where stochasticity, better to put it, because it gives us something, but even without stochasticity, something is interesting. Point is that this physical process, Laplacian growth, which I'm talking about, it is really nonlinear dissociative equilibrium, it's really highly unstable. And even if we have very good mathematical news about integrability, which means bluntly recovery of the interface dynamics as function of time and space, it's all unstable and therefore not of high reliability in a sense, because without fluctuation, this system is not serious to talk about deterministically, except some cases. There is another serious reason why stochastic Laplacian growth is important. Many years ago, diffusion limited aggregation universal fractal growth was observed in two-dimensional square lattice. For those, even if I guess you know, but for those who still doesn't, I very briefly remind that if you take two-dimensional square lattice, say, on the screen of your computer, put one seat, one side black, others are white, and generate by random number sources a black little square somewhere around perimeter, and require him in a Brownian motion style to jump with 25% probability to west, east, south, and north, earlier or later, this guy will arrive to the one of four next neighbors of this black guy. If he jumps away from the screen, we either generate a new one or put boundary periodic condition on torus, and he will continue his travel. Once he attached, rules of the game is to glue once it's next to the major seed. A new one is generated, so to speak, Brownian guy number three, and he arrives also earlier or later, this time already to 6 instead of 4 possibilities to become a next neighbor. And after he glues himself, we already have a cluster of 3 sites. So far, that goes until after several next thousand, we see ramified fractal tree with fractal spectrum, which after neglect of little insignificant things, all fractal dimensions, which after probabilistic ringy is called TQ, they all turn out to be the same. And each of them equals approximately 1.71 plus minus 1 divided by 100. Assume a set which we partition by this mesh boxing over little boxes with linear size epsilon, which is much less than linear size of this diameter of this set. Let's call P a probability that given site number I is occupied. It may be purely black, it may be purely white, in which case it is 0. And Ferenc Ringy, in the beginning of the 50s, proposed this set of numbers. He was motivated by Shannon-Boltzmann entropy. He mentioned that complex systems should be really well characterized. We have one global statistical number to characterize global system. It is Boltzmann-Shannon entropy. But one number is not enough to characterize really complex shape. But this list of numbers, total, Q is integer number. Maybe sufficient often full, but sometimes just sufficient. That's what he suggested. It is much later started multifractal business using this DQ and some Brazilian or non-extensive statistics, which I better not dwell on. It was after this was introduced. We know that, statistically speaking, systems may be self-similar, may not. Self-similar merely means that level of complexity is invariant with respect to scaling change or to zooming. And just let's have a look here. If Q equals 0, it coincides with Hausdorff dimension, which is positive integer for well-known compact objects, but maybe fractional for fractals. Look for D1. In D1, in Q equals 1, we have 0, because logarithm of 1 is 0, divided by 0, because 1 minus 1 equals 0. After L'Hopital, you will see that up to non-significant constant, it is Boltzmann, here it's minus, it is Boltzmann-Shannon entropy. If you calculate D2, actually it's already average, yes. So we have, so to speak, first pair correlating function. And higher levels can be possible to show, can be shown to be identical to high point correlation function. So it is a really useful list of numbers. And if all these numbers do not depend on Q, it is monofractal. Despite those reasonable and sometimes even impressive progress, analytical derivation of these numbers is still out of reach. Even if there are several very good advances in it. Because, and for those who skipped my previous lecture, I remind, because in a viscous fingering physical process where we have two-dimensional Darcy law, where V is vector field of viscous fluid and P is pressure in two dimensions and kinetic coefficient I took to be one here, and if we have incompressible fluid except several spots where we have sources or sinks, depending whether Q capital is positive or negative, and pressure. We have two fluids, viscous and inviscid. We will speak about viscous fluid. And in inviscid fluid, pressure is constant. And if to neglect surface tension, it means that pressure does not jump across the interface. And therefore, because it is constant, which we take liberty to take zero along the boundary. From that, it directly follows that pressure is nothing but linear combination of several Green functions of the two-dimensional Laplace operator with respect to the domain T. Indeed, Green function vanishes along the boundary by definition, logarithmically diverges near the source, and symmetric with respect to its two variables. From this simple, I would say at first sight, simple description, after kinematic identity, which requires that normal derivative of velocity coincides with the normal derivative of the fluid velocity at the boundary, we can easily obtain, using advantage of two-dimensional Laplace operator invariance with conformal map, in this equation, which is probably familiar, at least to those people who heard me earlier. And this equation has several remarkable mathematical properties, which I already mentioned. I would like to say that in the presence of several point-like sources, the moving boundary parameterized by phi is governed by this bilinear differential equation. Well, strictly speaking, integral differential, but so far you can neglect this difference. Here, Q is strength of source, as I mentioned, and inverse value of AK, which is inside the unit circle on the auxiliary mathematical plane W, which we use in order to make conformal map to the exterior of our growing domain. I don't want to bother you how we map infinity to infinity, exterior to exterior, because all this is, so to speak, preliminary information. And I would like to say that conformal map of this point, which certainly is outside the unit circle, because A lives inside, it belongs to the conformal domain, and its value is exactly the location of the source number K. Enough about that. Idea was to make a bridge between two processes which have really a lot in common. It is this Laplacian growth, which I will show to be the classical limit of the theory I want to show, and TLA, which I would like to call quantum limit of the same theory, because it corresponds to the maximal correlation between particles which land after each other. After I described you or reminded you about TLA, I ask you to agree with me that when the particle number k lands, next particle number k plus 1 already feels slight change of the field of probability, because boundary also slightly changed, however little is the size of the landed particle. In this way, we should say that correlations are on the level of each particle. At the same time, if I claim that this theory is classical limit, it does correspond to oppositely the minimal, almost next to zero correlation between moving particles. Of course, correlation exists, but on really macro scale. Correlations here exist exclusively on the macro scale that next big group of particles already knows some change and accordingly adjusts to get even more complex shape because of intrinsic instability. Last point I'd like to mention before start develop theory is that a lot of efforts were done to describe difference and commonalities between these two processes. Many papers were published claiming that these two processes belong to the different class universalities. I asked good experimentalists to measure fractal dimension of the real, in the real hydrodynamical laboratory where viscous fluid, which was pushed by less viscous fluid, organized fractal-like forest and tree, and it looks like a fractal, at least for several decades of scale, and the report was that up to T number, Q number 17, all T were equal to each other and equal to this number. We which confirmed my guess that they seem to be the same, in the same class, and therefore probably it is easier to study diffusion limited aggregation if our goal is exclusively TQ using Laplacian growth classical theory, because we know many remarkable mathematical features of this theory. Enough about that. I'd like to tell you stochastic Laplacian growth. Just a short reminder before I start, the harmonic measure. The harmonic measure of the domain T from the source A for the little fragment of the boundary between C and C plus DC equals by definition normal derivative of green function times scale size of this fragment. From electrostatical point of view, it's just charge density. From hydrodynamical point of view, it's just local velocity of the moving interface. From standard probabilistic point of view, it is a probability that a particle issued at A will land exactly at this specific fragment. Therefore, total flux is scaled by one here. In future, I'd like to drop this unnecessary label and this unnecessary label and maybe even this unnecessary label, but N will remind me that we are talking about M's fragment. Now, what's the difference between a standard TLA and the process I would like to describe? Difference number one. Instead of one particle, I will issue integer positive number k particles, which equals one for TLA, but when it goes to infinity, provided size of particle goes to zero, so product holds constant, it gives me Laplacian growth equation theory. Also, my particles are a little bit flexible. Loosely speaking, they are quadrangles of this size. Their shape is given by really curvilinear quadrangles shaped by potential level sets and orthogonal level of stream functions. So this is, as you can see, the area. I also assume, instead of a single source at infinity, m sources, which are located at am and have strengths km, not q. Q is for hydrodynamical classical limit. K, because it's still stochastic process. What I mean by that, that after you emit, issue k particles, they very, very quickly diffuse, really quickly, because this time is much shorter than slow time of growing interface, and they all instantaneously land over the moving boundary. They can land in such a way that into a single fragment, many particles can land. But I would like to emphasize that all of them are not correlated. So correlation goes down, once k goes up. K equals 1 corresponds to the maximal correlation. I would like, this is total number of particles issued per second. Infinitely, but source at infinity also may exist among them. As you can easily guess, this is area of a single layer attached to an elementary time unit. Because we would like to go close soon to classical theory, I would like to contact this increment of area to already partial area for m source. Two things. Because in classical limit, which responds to classical strength of source, which literally means quantity of fluid taken out or immersed, times delta t, which is taken as discrete infinitesimally small time unit. And let me introduce the layer description. The layer description indicates how much particles landed at the fragment number 1, at the fragment number 2, and finally at the fragment number n. In a sense, it is a matrix. Now, I would like to remind you well-known elementary combinatorical problem from high school, that if we have k balls with n, did I mention you? I hope I did, that we partition our moving interface onto the n capital little segments, and from here it follows that linear size of segment is square root of h, so this is perimeter. So if I have k balls and n boxes, multinomial description is the probability of a given distribution. This is exponent, and this is also exponent. KMN indicates that from source number M to the fragment number N, exactly K particles landed. And in high school level, mu N of AM stands just for a probability that balls of this color follow to box number n, and this is probability of it. In the Stirling limit, when Km is very large, I would like to rewrite this in this exponential way. nothing but so-called Kolbe-Leibler entropy in the exponent. This is entropy, which is actually difference between two distributions in infinitely dimensional probability space between two distributions. This distribution and distribution which indicated here. The first inclination is, since in a Pansinum limit, even at discrete level, if we consider K as a stochastic field, and using Lagrange multiplier, this constraint, where is this constraint? Here is this constraint. Using standard elementary variational calculus, we obtain that this probability, maximum of this probability, is exactly what you see at the bottom of this fraction. And I would like to say that this probability in the limit when Planck constant goes to zero is exponentially sharp. Don't want to show you this symbol. Therefore, all fluctuations are suppressed. Consequently, this distribution of the stochastic field is a classical trajectory for this stochastic process. And if we take into account already in the classical limit that normal velocity of the boundary times delta t, which means nothing but displacement of the boundary for elementary time, because it has square root of h, which is linear size, multiplied by multiplied by this sum. From here, immediately follows this formula, and I pray I did not erase it, which means the Laplacian growth equation in the presence of several sources. If we have only one single source, moreover, at infinity, this equation takes a form which may be more familiar, at least to some of you. Suddenly, everything was taken into account. It was maximum. Second quadratic form was positive before this minus and exponentially sharp, so it's all good. So it's interesting. However simple and elementary it looks like, I would like to mention that, to my best knowledge, this Laplacian growth equation was obtained earlier from viscous hydrodynamics as a viscous limit of the Navier-Stokes equation, or from kinetics, but not from the variational principle based on elementary combinatorics. So this is, so to speak, the first result which I wanted to mention to you. Now, I forgot to mention to you one more motivation for this theory. It was interesting to think about a probability of a given complex shape. To be more specific, if we start from the same initial configuration, for simplicity, from initially unit circle, and in this stochastic Laplacian growth way, we'll prepare something rather complex in a total time t, which lets this be integer multiple to delta t. we could guess, probabilistically speaking, continuously many of these contours which share the same area. The same area and also share the same initial conditions. It is very natural to inquire how to compare these probabilities. And because of that, I'd like to mention that in order to follow our line of treatment, we should accept that this shape can be obtained by continuously many different scenarios, continuously many in classical limit. Because in one scenario, this part grows earlier than that part. In another scenario, other way around. And because of all these scenarios are independent, we should add independent probability, shouldn't we? Therefore, I say that probability of total probability of a given shape, non-normalized, is just a sum over probabilities per scenario. Let me put here this strange K, which is not this strange symbol like that I used it, but anyway. So this is sum over all scenarios. And each of these scenarios is a product of given scenario of given set of layers, where I stands for the discrete time. And we are lucky that this process is Markov process, which implies no memory, which implies that if you want to know probability at I second, all you have to know is probability is a shape which was 1 second earlier, multiplied by conventional probability that given fragment is growth, so it's really simple. In this way, I have to mention that we extend standard path integration through the space of scenario in this strange space. And that's what we plan to do. But before to move on, I have to introduce you to important concept which I and my co-author call virtual sources. Let me tell you what it means. Because of probabilistic nature, we cannot be surprised if over the reasonably smooth interface we have rather non-trivial complex layer, and even many of them. Of course, we should attribute this fact to the probabilistic nature of our process. It's only in classical limit deterministic process. However, it is also possible to think that it is still classical deterministic process. What I mean that during this single discrete unit of time, this configuration appeared because of several sources outside the growing cluster just worked in this discrete element of time. This worked with strength Q1 and is located at A1, etc. possible. Moreover, it is possible to prove that situation is dense, and you can always describe complex layer by list of these points. This, I would say, significantly helps what I am doing now, because after this, nice mathematical observation will come. Because of that, I can replace KMN, which so far was stochastic field, by classical deterministic value, which I hopefully did not erase, because now virtual sources, okay, I can put here K, but let's not forget that this equals this. And now I can just replace this, as I said, by fork of virtual sources. Yes, virtual sources, which is exactly this guy, but probably I move too fast. Probably what I should do now is to introduce the edge. Yes, let's introduce the edge. I claim that probability of a given scenario is negative inverse Planck constant multiplied by the following time integral. Everything now is time dependent. And yeah, it's just edge. Yes, it is edge that we found that its minimal value is exactly a classical trajectory. Now I would like to remind you, real TLA has only single source at infinity. In this case, this action, we have only single summation because only one source, and this source is at infinity, total K. Now, and this is N. Now, after we did that, then we say, hey, this probability creates stochastic layers. We attribute these stochastic layers to virtual sources, and therefore replace stochastic field by classical level, by classical regime of these stochastic sources, which is exactly this. It's logarithm of this, yes, Km, and this is also mu n Km. The rest is simple. This is also a Kullback-Leibler entropy, who in information theory compares the difference between two entropies. And after we take care of these numbers, just it's easy to take care, it goes as combinatorial factor, which goes to pre-exponent. We see here, by the way, I also would like to go to continuous limit along the perimeter. Moreover, I would like now to focus my attention on a single layer. Yes. It's dimensionless, yes. I would like to replace this guys by normal derivative of gain function, which they are by definition. That's all. I would like to mention that after some interesting, not very lengthy, identical transformations, which I skip now, this expression turns out to be factorized both by time and by layers. And what I would like to do, I would like to write you the final result. There are two complex planes, physical complex plane C, where cluster grows, and auxiliary mathematical conformal complex plane W, where unit circle and its interior is a key players. And I would like to show you what this exponent equals to in both of these planes. First, W plane. I claim that probability of a given layer K equals up to combinatorial factor, which just believe me, not important at all, equal sum over sources of Km logarithm of 1 minus a n squared. This is our first result. As I promised, we see here factorization of this probability with respect to different sources. Moreover, this logarithm has transparent electrostatic interpretation. It is nothing but value of electrostatic potential at the inverse A bar point where we have unit charge, and it is induced. This is created by induced charges along the unit circumference, and these charges are induced exactly because of his existence. Some people call it Robin function. I can even show you another and probably even more instructive way to show this. You see here just self-interaction of a charge, induced charge, harmonically redistributed along the unit circle as a reaction on the unit charge at this point outside the unit circle. So it all has purely electrostatic interpretation. You may ask why I emphasize that it is important. Well, first of all, we started from purely probabilistic object, entropy, logarithm of probability. And we end up to something of purely energetic electrostatic nature. But what is even more important, that now we see Gibbs Boltzmann distribution. And this is really something very interesting. As you can agree with me, this process of Laplacian growth or DLA is really highly non-equilibrium process. And even if we know that Gibbs Boltzmann distribution very often is nicely applicable for small deviations from equilibrium. It is a bit striking, for me at least, that here we also obey Gibbs-Boltzmann distribution with interesting perspectives, which I don't have today enough time to discuss. I would like to mention that this Robin function, as people from fluid dynamics told me, and as you can easily see, it is just a regular part of green function of unit circle after we subtracted divergent logarithmic part. This obeys trivially integrable nonlinear Liouville equation. It's not accidental because this result is nothing but semi-classical limit of n correlating function in the Liouville theory for so-called light operators. This presentation is devoted to classical limit, but we work on quantum extension, and without big promises, we try to see something on the level of quantum regime in framework of Liouville. In pseudosphere, we have interesting things, because conformal factor, which is just exponential of this regular part of the green function. This conformal factor describes geometry on pseudosphere. 5 minutes left, thank you. And in this way, this unit circle, which we use so often when we did conformal map, presents nothing but the absolute for the Poincaré disk of Lobachevsky pseudosphere. And in this way, singularities which are inside the unit circle, and some of you know, heard me earlier, that when they move toward the unit circle, they start to really slow down. Some make cusp, but I don't like cusp. They have enough of regular solutions. And in regular solution, they never, neither critical point nor singularities never reach unit circle from inside. It is exactly why our interface still is analytic the whole time. And while they slow down here exponentially slow, in a real pseudosphere, it corresponds that they move with constant velocity. But I promised, and I asked the chairman just 3 minutes maximum, or maybe two, but I don't want to misuse your kindness. Just 3 minutes, okay? So far, what I have shown to you is exclusively W-plane. However, if I show you this probability in C-plane, it is not less fruitful, actually. First of all, I can show that our probability is also sum of its overall probability is, actually I want to speak about single source, okay? A single layer, actually. It is and this this time it is already on C plane instead of W plane. And again, we see here self-interacting energy of charge, say positive charge, induced by the same source A, and it's the, however, here extra factors which I call measure, and I appreciate I don't have enough time to discuss, but it helps us to figure out measure of path integrations, which I really skip now. But I want to mention that if we transform this contour integrals to double integrals, and it is not very trivial because of logarithmic cut here, but we will get a result which reminds me very much result for logarithm of tau function did by several people a while ago. Minus we need in order to guarantee positive electrical repulsion. And the difference is that here we have only a layer. By layer, I merely name what is left. And therefore, the total probability is summation over all these energies plus so-called modified Schwarz potential, which no time to discuss much. But to be honest, my initial inclination was to obtain really logarithm of tau function in a classical limit, which was obtained a while ago. But it was with respect to the whole domain, not layers. And as you see, if single integral is additive, double integral is not additive. And therefore, this sum is not this integral over the whole layer. And now I understand a little bit better why semi-classical and normal matrices efforts, which were performed with respect to this object, did not provide, unfortunately, fractal dimension, which is just this fractal dimension, because the subtle difference is that it goes layer by layer. This stochastic layer approach may help. Probably I have one sentence to complete, and after this I will appreciate you for your attention and patience. My last sentence is that the same interesting theory, that the same probability can be described in a color matrix. We here have first fundamental form where G is this harmonic moments of this domain. And of Hermitian matrices, manifold. And this Hermitian manifold is color manifold. And it gives certain geometrical flow. But it is certainly outside the scope. So probably I don't have to make conclusions, but at least I wanted, at least I told you main things performed here. And I want to thank all listeners for attention and patience.